except for those times when I might have the pleasure of offering Mass in our home chapel, the Chapel of the Annunciation, the chapel where Father Justin will soon offer Mass as well. This is what you call preaching to the choir. This choir represents three generations of Bolgers and loved ones and spouses as well, and represented in Jacob the third generation, Martin Sue's first son and child. It wouldn't be, of course, the first Mass without sibling participation as well, not just from the pulpit, but musically, lecturing, and one hand chill for the arts and environment where she's done as well. What a gift Father Justin is now to the church, and what a gift this is for mom and dad in this beautiful season of their marriage, that they can celebrate their son's priestly vocation and first Mass. Thank goodness in real person and not through the TV screen, as you did yesterday and did for the ordination. To that end, I want to thank the pastor of this parish, Father Christian Mullins, for your hospitality, as well as the moderator of the oratory, St. Bolger, Monsignor Andrew Wadsworth, for your hospitality as well, for planning the wording for us at this Mass. You truly carry on the spirit of the founder, St. Philip Neri, whose feast we celebrate on Tuesday. And you can see this beautiful image of St. Philip Neri during his Novena days. Now, although the choir can be here with us, so many family members can, and thanks to the brothers here through this live stream and through Facebook, we recognize that we have family from the West Coast in California probably joining us, so many family members in New York, maybe some family in Atlanta, Georgia, down in Florida, and even a cousin might be watching from Switzerland with his family as well. So many can join us because of this live stream. To push the musical metaphor, I began without preaching to the choir, I'd like to highlight the melodic triad that comprises the priesthood, the priestly or sacramental office, the prophetic or teaching office, and finally the kingly or shepherding office. And while this triad is the melody on which the priesthood stands, the harmonic triad, which complements this melody, can be found in the evangelical councils of poverty, chastity, and obedience, and Archbishop Gregory preached those yesterday at the ordination. Father Justin, as a priest of the Dominican Order, now shares in both. So let me briefly highlight this melody of the priesthood as we listen to the harmony of the evangelical councils against each note. The divine providence of heaven, the sacred scripture the church has given us for the ascension of the Lord, serves to remind us that Jesus, before he ascended to the Father, entrusted to his first priests, those 11 apostles, a great commission, a priestly commission, through and through. But just, I know you know this already, but I'll say it anyway. Each time you preach, whether it's to a friendly choir like this, or sometimes a congregation that might not be as receptive, you're also preaching to yourself. I say this because I know that I, along with at least some of the members of the choir this morning, we feel a lot like the 11 apostles, who pose a common question to Jesus, as recorded in Acts chapter 1. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? Our question takes the form of, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to the Catholic Church? What is going on, Lord? Where are we? Can't you see that the bark of Peter is taking on so much water? Why are our churches so locked down? Where is the sense of urgency? We need you to act, Lord. The Lord's answer is direct today as it was 2,000 years ago. It is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has established for his own authority. Jesus once again has to correct the apostles' misunderstanding. Since the Jew received power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, to the ends of the earth. Father Justin has received this same priestly mission through his sacred ordination. Jesus is bringing the Baptist kingdom, though, to all of you who are baptized and confirmed in the faith. But in a privileged and unique way, Jesus is establishing his kingdom through Father Justin's ordination as priesthood. So first, there is a priestly or sacramental office. Jesus made his instructions dummy-proof before he ascended. He didn't say, I want you to create huge bureaucratic structures or fancy slogans drawn up by PR gurus to spread on the internet to make the church grow. No, he said quite simply, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, not some nations, all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The hands of the priest. Brother Justin, you already baptized as a deacon, Henry, who's with us in the narthex, as young families so often do. They turn from the narthex, the sacrifices of our families, of our siblings, who said yes so generously to the gift of life. You will confirm sometime, probably, Easter vigil in one of your parishes. You will make Jesus present for the first time as a principal celebrant today at this altar. Through your words and actions, you will cause God to respond to what you said. You will bring treasure from heaven to us. You will forgive sins, the words of absolution. You will anoint the sick, the spoil of the sick. You'll act as an indispensable witness on behalf of the church for the sacrament of matrimony. As you have been considered, it's all about grace. And this is why you are absolutely right and essential to the life of the church. All of our faithful need grace now. Grace is essential. So we're praying that very soon our church is open so that the faithful can receive this essential food. Regardless, though, of this poverty of spirit to priesthood, you will bring to it through your priesthood this poverty that you accepted, Brother Justin. Poverty of spirit. This is of our mind and of overtone. Jesus once said, without cost you have received, without cost you are to give. Your founder, St. Dominic, knew that this newly formed order needed to offer a credible witness to those who are trying to engage and bring back into faith, to embrace physical poverty as far as order stirs. It still, of course, is a great mirror today. I'd like to conclude this first note of priesthood and a harmonic counterpoint of poverty to the spiritual component. You think of St. Teresa of Calcutta, who we found out lived for so many years, 40 years or so, without any sense of consolation in her prayer. Every day, receiving the Holy Eucharist, Mass, and the Holy Hour. But she didn't feel that consolation. She instead had a great poverty, a tremendous poverty. She was poor in spirit. She would reveal to us, though, that the way that her poverty and her thirst was satiated was through doing likewise for Jesus, who said, I thirst and suffer. And so her priesthood, the more that you have that poverty of spirit, complete dependence of God, even in those moments of darkness, he will work through you in the most efficacious way. The second note, the prophetic or teaching office. Again, Jesus makes it crystal clear what he wants his first priests to do once they receive the grace of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. Jesus says, teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. You will teach them the pulpit. You will teach through your music. I'm looking forward to the second little tone CD coming out. Hopefully very soon, recorded later this summer. You will teach through your way of life. What is the one thing necessary, though, if you're going to be an effective preacher, who preaches to hearts, convicting and calling them to holiness, in the word, chastity. Chastity is a harmonic counterpoint, the prophetic or teaching office. Jesus said in the Beatitudes, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. I'm convinced that a major factor that has contributed to the silence of so many important moral issues on behalf of our bishops and priests that have been compromised in the area of chastity. Say this as a sinner, but one who has received the grace and the desire for chastity in my own priesthood. And I know how important it is if we are going to call our people to holiness and teach with any level of credibility. This is what's going to bring about reform in church. It's from this place of chastity that you will be able to share the fruits of your contemplation, a great deal. chastity. Our step for the Blessed Sacrament, the Holy Spirit will give you the insights in which to preach and to teach. And what is the key to chastity? This beautiful shrine in front of me, to Our Lady. Mary is the key to chastity. Now, you are forced to remember that because you wear a rosary around your waist. But we all know that it's much more than that. And it takes years of developing that marriage prayer and priesthood will guarantee you true chastity, to be purpose conceived without sin. Now, finally, I want to end this section with an exhortation from St. Paul. 2 Timothy chapter 4, he says, I give you this charge, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage, with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come, the people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to miss. But you keep your head in all situations, and your heart should do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your priestly ministry. The final office, that of shepherd. Jesus concludes the Great Commission before he ascends to the Father by saying to his first priests, and behold, I am with you always until the end of the age. This is the key to the office of shepherds. The more Jesus is with you and in you, the more you configure your life to Jesus, the Good Shepherd, the more people will want to follow you because they will see Jesus in you. To be a good shepherd, never the hireling that St. Gregory the Great warns about, who when the wolf comes, runs away from the sheep. To be a good pastor, you must place yourself in the garden of Gethsemane. You must pray again and again, Father, not my will, but your will be done. This is why obedience is the harmonic counterpoint to the office of shepherd. To listen attentively to the voice of the Lord, to submit your will to the will of the Father and your superiors. This is what will make you a good shepherd after the heart of Jesus Christ. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't conclude by quoting